So the idea is you should be able to apply finite element methods proficiently and critically to solve engineering problems at the end of this. You should be able to choose the appropriate engineering analysis. So one of the advantages going to a really fundamental understanding of this is hopefully that gives you an understanding of how you can actually apply the different techniques. And you can understand the limitations of these modeling methodologies. We'll talk about some of the current practices and limitations. So because we're starting fundamental, towards the end we'll try to get some more applied applications in and get some people in to talk to you about those. But you know, really the idea of this is starting very, very simple. And then the problem solving, communication and information retrieval will be part of your group work. So you're working together and you'll have to do some kind of research yourself. Okay. So the assessment, groups of three. You're going to generate a report that you submit together, but a report will focus on basically a finite element code in MATLAB. You're going to write the mathematics of that, then you're going to write the actual code of that, and then you're going to validate that as a series of solutions. Basically, the marks will be assigned based on essentially an understanding. So these lectures hopefully will get you the kind of understanding you need for that, and in tutorials you can develop that code and make sure it works. And then finally, the oral exam will be carried out to make sure members of the group will hold their weight, essentially. Okay, so there's normally a question about this course, is why we go so fundamental, because it's an advanced module. You obviously want things that will be linked to industry. And you talk to industry, they want this skill, they want this particular program, they want you to know how to use this. The problem is, we can't teach you every possible framework that they want. So the idea really is to kind of go back and take an idea of the fundamentals of the methodology. And by having that, you can then essentially use any package that you come across, and you have an understanding of, you know, when you do the drop-down box and you choose this numerical solver, or this grid resolution, or this boundary condition, what that actually means from a fundamental level. So hopefully you'll get a feeling for stability and choice of which numerical solutions you want. Understand physically the different terms in the equation, and the effect of those terms and the modeling assumptions. The importance of grid resolution, this is a common thing that they say in industry is kind of lacking, is, you know, a fundamental kind of feel for what works and what doesn't for numerical solutions. And then really understanding what boundary conditions are, how to apply them, what they mean. So that's why we kind of focus in on that. If there is something particularly you hope to get from this that's missing, fill in the survey, or use the QR code and essentially, you can do that right with your phone. You hold up the phone and you get that, perfect. So feel free to just, you know, register if you're feeling like we're not covering a particular thing you'd like to know about. I'll try and link it in, try and make sure that we cover that at least to some extent. Yeah, and try to get something. But there's no way we cover every cutting edge application, but we'll try to kind of at least show where they link it. Okay, so lecture one, you've seen the plan. Lecture two, we're going to start with a recap. That recap will be based on the survey. So if everyone says, you know, no idea what you're talking about, I'll do my best to kind of recover things. Then we'll go into more detail of the shape functions, differential equations, weighted residual method, and then talk about the link between local and global shape functions, and then basically go through a series of examples so you understand one-dimensional finite element approach. And we're doing one dimensions, it's not the most exciting case, but hopefully it'll give you a sort of firm foundation. By lecture three, we'll go on and actually start to talk about some programming. You're doing a MATLAB course this week, is that right? You've got a kind of introduction for that. Okay. So depending on, again, your feedback and also how you feel, I could introduce MATLAB earlier on or later on. By week or lecture three, hopefully we'll be in a place where we can start to solve some things with MATLAB, as well as look at just the mathematics. And then we'll look in a bit more detail. By lecture four, we'll go into two dimensions, look at kind of fundamental shape functions, and then go to more complicated examples. By lecture six, we'll have the kind of general case that you'll do for the assessment question, and we'll link it to industrial applications and some practical tips. Okay, so in terms of books, there's a reading list for the course. These two extra books I haven't put on there, I'll put them on soon. If you talk to most people about finite element analysis, these books will be the ones they recommend. The one on the left is fairly mathematical. The one on the right is you know, the Bible for finite element analysis. So these are kind of the most commonly recommended. But I would say, unfortunately, you know, what you find is it's a pretty steep gradient. So I'm not sure how well you can see this, but let me try out the pen. So if you look at this, you know, this is page one of this book. You essentially have the notation mu, comma, xx, which is, you know, a really concise way of writing d2 by dx squared. You know, and then by line two, you're talking about kind of set interval notation. So x is an element of zero and one. You know, even for someone who spends a lot of time in mathematics, it's pretty dense mathematical notation. I think you'll find this quite commonly with most sources for finite element analysis. Similarly, if you look at sort of the different source here, you've actually got kind of probably slightly more friendly notation, you know, matrix, but these matrices themselves are themselves like tensor vectors, and so it's all pretty dense, it's all pretty hard to get into. So the idea hopefully is these lectures will be self-contained, and I'll try to give you enough background that you can at least find the literature accessible. I'm hoping most of you have got a good enough background to at least understand this, but again, any questions on notation, anything you don't understand, please feel free to ask me. So this is an example for Wikipedia, and again you can see, you know, it's fairly steep inlet. So you can see that you've got the sort of derivative notation there, you've got basically mixed notation where this is a derivative, you know, written in a different way, talking about domains. Essentially it's you know, not the most accessible subject. Okay, so that's the introduction to the course. Do we have any questions? Does that make sense? Any questions about the assessment method? Okay. So let's talk about some motivations for learning finite element analysis. So I'm going to talk about three application areas. The first one is the kind of engineering problems. And these are probably what you expect, the reason you're learning. We're in engineering university, engineering department. You know, this is really the key application. But I also want to give a kind of slightly broader picture of this in terms of film graphics and computer games. Now, you know, generally what we're learning here is coding. We're learning how to model physics on a computer. So the idea here is that these are kind of generally applicable techniques that will set you up for a range of different industries. So if you kind of pay attention to these courses, hopefully we can build you up with enough background that you at least, you know, have an idea of how you'd actually go and get involved with these kind of other areas where engineering, you know, understanding of physics and modelling it is kind of very important. So let's start with a simplest example. This is just, you know, a vanilla application of finite element analysis. We build a three-dimensional grid, we apply some tension force to it, and you see some resulting strain field for that. So this would be a very simple simulation you do for just modelling uniform tension, for example. So fairly mundane, fairly boring, but obviously important for lots of applications. Slightly more interesting, for anyone who works in aero, has probably seen this video, but you know, the case of a blade failure has fairly catastrophic consequences, as you can see, in terms of destruction of the engine and probably subsequent flight being down. So essentially, what we aim to do with finite element analysis or modelling in general would be to try to predict when that's happening and prevent that from happening. You can see the results are fairly catastrophic. So this application here, you can see the comparison between the finite element and the actual experiment, and we're modelling that blade shearing off in both cases. So again, this is one of the very useful applications of this methodology. Another quite complicated application is in crash prediction, designing cars essentially to withstand crashes. You can see here essentially a model. These are quite non-linear calculations. Essentially, we're modelling, you know, the application of a car and building up as a series of elements and looking how that would. This is a, you know, fairly complicated modelling problem. Maybe not that exciting, but essentially we have moving vanes which have a fluid flowing over them. So we have both solids and liquids together. The interaction between those two. Together is you know, kind of modelled here, and you can see the kind of quite complicated interface of the physics. And this is using ANSYS here, so I'm sure you've worked in kind of quite complicated situations like this. Okay, this is something from my research. This is a kind of fundamental physics of turbulent flow. So when you've essentially got the minimal size at which turbulence can be sustained, you can actually model this kind of complex, repeating, chaotic structure. And from that you can understand the kind of fundamentals of turbulence and then use that to predict, essentially on a larger scale, how that's going to affect flight, car movement, etc. So, you know, as a fundamental research tool, numerical modelling is very, very important. And we're still kind of trying to understand how fluids behave. This is again from my research, simulation of boiling here. Essentially you're modelling both, you know, the Navier-Stokes equation, but also the interface between the liquid and the vapour. And then you're heating and you're seeing the kind of formation of an initial nucleation bubble, its growth, its coalescence with various other bubbles, and then the formation of a film. So, you know, we're predicting here boiling, which is useful for many industrial processes, or just, you know, making a cup of tea. So, range of different applications. Okay, so coming to films, this is an example from the Avengers film, Age of Ultron. And what you can see here is, you know, an example of physics. So here we're seeing essentially this kind of cracking of the ground is actually modelled by a series of individual elements or particles, if you like, and they essentially build that simulation up and then render it over the top. So this type of modelling is becoming kind of very, very commonplace in films, in the film industry. So if we look at, you can see here essentially the model is made up of a series of pieces, and then the physics of those are governed by fundamental, you know, the kind of equations we'll talk about in this course. So you know, hopefully it's a you know, potential application that you know, you can at least use these techniques for. So this is an example from a game, and essentially when you have some sort of physics, we have like a blast or something like that, the actual model for the destruction of a particular thing is actually again made up of a series of pieces. Those pieces will move in a particular way, and again that's dominated by the physics. Strictly speaking, it's probably not finite element analysis. This is probably closer to it, with these kind of guide ropes being based on some sort of tension calculation. But essentially, you know, you're doing an approximation of physics real time that comes as close as possible to something that looks good and essentially reproduces a representation of reality. So this is probably more kind of rigid body dynamics rather than FEA. But this example here, you're actually splitting the domain up into a series of pieces, and you're modelling how that deforms, how that moves. So again, it's all this kind of idea of modelling, splitting the domain up into pieces, modelling how those pieces change. And then the final example is kind of really simplified model of reality from Minecraft. This is an example where you can see through the walls. And this is quite nice because essentially it's, you know, a series of cubes. So the world's made up of a series of boxes. And those boxes have associated physics. You can hit them and they deform or change in a particular way. And you know, that's all kind of well defined and based on a set of physical laws. So essentially this computer code of a world made of pieces. Okay, so hopefully that kind of gave you some ideas of the kind of motivation. We're going to move now and talk about the mathematics. Essentially starting with functions. Now, the first point to make is that computers store information as binary numbers, and this information is stored to a finite precision. So everything on a computer is an approximation, if you like. So you're essentially storing a series of vertices or grid that represent space. So as you've seen from all of those examples, the Minecraft is a really good example because it's a series of boxes. So the world is made up of a series of boxes, and those boxes are kind of the smallest discrete unit of that world. It's a representation of that, and then you can, you know, model how that moves around by a set of laws. Essentially, we're doing the same thing with a more complicated battlefield game, where there was essentially things breaking into pieces, and those pieces are actually, you know, made of even smaller elements. But you know, essentially, still this idea of breaking the system up into a series of discrete parts, because that's all a computer can store. So more generally, this kind of links in with the underlying idea of physics, and it's encapsulated quite nicely by this kind of pretentious quote from Karl Popper, years before computers. But the idea that theories are these nets that we cast to catch what we call the world, to rationalise, to explain, to master it. So we're aiming to make the mesh finer and finer, get better and better at approximation of the real world from our models. So that's really the idea of all of this methodology. Try and get a good description of reality, use that to predict what's going to happen, whether a plane will crash, whether a car will crash, you know, in a computer game what happens. So the limiting case of this, if we could go to infinite resolution, and we could zoom in and zoom in and zoom in until essentially each of those elements were infinitely small, would give us the mathematical concept of a function. So you've used these, you've seen these since you were, you know, an undergrad, but essentially this mathematical function is a way of representing something in the real world. Mathematics is only really useful when you use it. And so mathematics in this case, we're basically representing something as a function. That function could be a car, that function could be a description of something. But essentially, the mathematical function is the kind of limiting case, if you like, of this idea of taking a grid where we go to infinite resolution. And the reason we're talking about this is because we're going to start with the mathematical underpinnings and understand that, and then we're going to discretize that. And we're going to build up essentially a discrete world that we use to approximate these mathematical functions. And then the link between these mathematical functions as we zoom in will give us an idea of how good our models are. So when we refine our grid, we're essentially trying to get back to this mathematical ideal of the exact function. But as you'll see, you can never actually do that. Just a brief note on this kind of underpinning assumption. Now, this whole area of finite element analysis is an applied version of what's called continuum mechanics. Continuum mechanics is the study of continuous substances, you know, essentially things that are filled solid, not made of discrete parts. And this continuum assumption underpins pretty much all of modern physics, all of engineering. And essentially what that states formally is f is continuous, some function is continuous, if the limit that x tends to c exists. So you'll find this in the mathematics textbook. That requires two things. Firstly, the function is smooth enough that you can tend to that point, and also that that point exists. Now what that means is, you know, you've defined a function with properties that allow you to kind of tend to a particular point in space. There's also this more formal epsilon delta definition that lets you play around with this concept. I'm not expecting you to understand this or worry too much about it. I just want you to understand that everything we talk about really is underpinned by this assumption that in the idealized world it should be a continuum, and everything we're doing is an approximation to that. The better the resolution, the closer to the continuum, the better that approximation. Now the key point where this function becomes useful is in the concept of the calculus, that is defining a derivative. So let's take, you know, some point on this line, and we look at two points, x and x plus delta x, which is the difference between those two points on that curve there. Now in order to get the gradient on that, the gradient of that curve, we can approximate by drawing a straight line between those two points. And the gradient is just the change in y divided by the change in x. Now the change in y, we get from basically the point f at x plus delta x minus the point f of x. And the difference between those two will essentially give us a change in y, and we change it by delta x in x. So the gradient to any point on the curve we can get essentially by doing this trick. We can take two points on the curve separated by delta x, and then we get the function at f plus delta x minus the function at x, and we retain the gradient. Now, mathematically, what we typically do in the calculus is we just keep zooming in, and we get to higher and higher resolution for that gradient. And in the limiting case, we basically end up with the calculus. So this is the underpinning idea of the calculus, and you've seen this, I'm sure, many, many times. Again, the thing I want to take away is actually this derivative, if you think about it, is actually kind of like a placeholder. It's something that's like an idealization, this idea that you can take an infinitely small point. You can never do that. So mathematically what we're saying with this is it's like a placeholder. It says that if we could get that limiting case, we'd be able to get the gradient at any point on that curve. And for pure mathematical functions, that's possible. In practice, what we have to do is some approximation for that. So what's nice now is we've got this definition of a gradient. That gradient allows us to define differential equations. So a differential equation is just an equation that has a derivative in it. Just some examples here, this is just the derivative is equal to zero, second derivative is equal to zero, second derivative plus some function is equal to zero. So these are all just examples of differential equations. And, you know, differential equations are exactly the same as any other equations. You know, think of some common equations, y equals mx plus c, equation for a straight line, or Newton's law, f equals ma. They're essentially the same thing, they just happen to have derivatives in. And actually, if you think about these equations, they are essentially differential equations. The gradient is actually dy by dx. Acceleration is the second derivative of position with respect to time. So, you know, really with differential equations, don't be too worried about them as concepts. They are, the real problem with them is they are tricky to solve. So just a bit of terminology. Basically, the order of the equation is the highest derivative in that equation. So we're looking basically at this is the first order, that's second order. Despite the fact you've got this term here, that's still second order because there's not actually, this is not counted. And again, this one third order term is what's important. So it's purely just the highest derivative. And this becomes important because it's the number of times we have to integrate it and how complicated they are to solve. Generally, second order is pretty much what you see in physics. No physical laws seem to have anything above second order for whatever reason. Now, the other thing to kind of be aware of is the difference between linear and non-linear equation. So, very roughly, any equation which contains a product of the unknown function, that's the function f here, is a non-linear function. So these are some examples. And these are the product of the function and any of its derivatives. So this is f times the derivative of f, that's the non-linear term here. This term isn't non-linear because you've got f times x, it's not times f itself. Similarly, this term, it's a fourth order term here, but it's actually this bit that's non-linear because it's f times f squared. So that's the non-linear term. And in this example here, the second derivative is times itself, so that's a non-linear equation. And the reason I mention these is because generally speaking, nonlinear equations can't be solved analytically. They end up with chaotic solutions, really complex behavior. Generally, numerics are the only way to go. It's actually a very, very small number of differential equations we can solve exactly. So to give you an idea of how we solve differential equations exactly, here's a couple of simple examples. Probably the simplest is dx is equal to a. And we can just integrate this directly. So we integrate both sides, we get f of x is a times x plus some arbitrary constant of integration. Now we'll come to boundary conditions next week, but essentially your boundary conditions are the same as these constants of integration. So these are the extra bits of information you need to supply in order to get a closed solution, if you like. Similarly, second order differential equation here, we differentiate, sorry, integrate twice. First integral gives us exactly the same as this, and then we're basically integrating a second time, and we get a quadratic function. So hopefully that's all fairly straightforward. When you start to get to more complicated differential equations, and I'm sure you've probably had to do this many times, with very, very complicated forms of differential equations, essentially there are a range of different tricks, and each of these tricks is probably someone's whole life work, finding some trick to solve those equations. So, you know, one example is if you've got this differential equation here, which we'll come back to later, essentially you have to form an equation where, you know, you take this second order term as basically m squared, this term as being just a constant coefficient, you get the roots of this equation, from that you can predict a solution of a particular form. There's no reason why you'd actually, well, you know, looking at this from the outside, there's no reason why you think of this yourself. This is something you have to be told. So a lot of these solutions require you to kind of learn a bunch of tricks in order to solve these equations. And there's things like integrating factors, trial solutions. You can do transforms. Green functions are slightly more general, but generally speaking, there's a very, very small number of differential equations we can solve. Non-linear ones or more complicated ones, essentially there's nothing we can do. So the numerics we talk about here will be the way to solve these equations. And most research typically will be with numerical solutions. And as I mentioned, nonlinear equations have these kind of chaotic, messy solutions, and there's no, it's unlikely to be a closed form solution. Okay, so how's that so far? Just give me an idea. Is this all stuff you know? It's all pretty basic, or yeah? Is anyone totally confused? Never seen any of this before? Okay, so We should have a chat after, but yeah, I mean, so your background's programming or software? Or? Okay, so I mean, if you put in a pre-course survey, let me know, and then we'll work out basically how to, I'll give you some background reading and some things just to get up to speed. So one of the things I'm going to try and do is keep a lot of this complexity out of the derivation of this, but you can't really read the literature without seeing this concept, so. We'll at least try to cover as much as possible. Okay, so the next thing I want to cover is basically just getting onto two dimensions and partial derivatives. So the first thing to note is in two dimensions we essentially have these functions of two variables, x and y. This is an example of a two-dimensional function. It's a function of x and has y dependent. So you can imagine in order to specify, you need to specify both an x position and a y position. Probably clear if we plot it. So you could think of this being like a hill, if you like. At any point in x and y, there's some height associated with that hill. And then moving in x, you know, essentially we change our value. You can see that's changed by the x value is changing. So if we have a value of 2 in there, the 2 will go into this x component, and you know, we get a different x value. Similarly, if we have a value of 2 of y, we put that in there, and we get different values at different points. So you know, when we start talking about two dimensions, they're functions of two variables, and you know, you think of them as fields, or if you like, you can think of them as kind of three-dimensional structures. But this is really the language of the kind of equations we'll be solving. Now you're learning MATLAB. There's a snippet of code here which just allows you to plot these functions you've seen. There's two different plots. Contour F will plot it as a color map. Surface will give you a kind of a two-dimensional or three-dimensional surface you just saw. So play around with this, see what happens when you change the coefficients, just get an idea of these. It's good to get a kind of intuitive feel for how these two-dimensional functions work and what they do. Okay, so you know, coming back to this kind of contour plot, and this is just the kind of, we looked downwards on that two-dimensional plot you've just seen there, and plotted it as colours. Essentially we can see the height being mapped by this number here. And so what we're going to do is we're going to actually take the same concept we've seen in one dimensions and just do it in two dimensions. That is, take some arbitrary square in space, and we're going to take the limit that as that square tends to a point in space, we can define derivatives. So exactly the same concept as on a line, we're taking the gradient, we're taking a square that's a, you know, some angle gives us the gradient at that point. So we're taking, for y, we're just going to take the kind of fixed point halfway up the square, and then we're taking x and x plus delta x, divided the difference with a difference of delta x. And we're interested in this limit as the square essentially gets smaller and smaller and smaller until it becomes a point. So we do that keeping y constant for a partial derivative. Now, whenever you see a partial derivative, essentially what that implies is that the other variable of interest is held constant. Now, x is a function of x and y, so it implies that y is constant here. Now, this notation is normally dropped, but just bear in mind that whenever you see a partial derivative, something is held constant. And essentially, it's exactly the same trick we saw before. Mathematically, this is a kind of placeholder in this limiting case that we can tend to an individual point in space. We can do exactly the same thing in y. Again, we're doing halfway across in x. And then the y value is between y and y plus delta y. And we take this limiting case that the square tends to a point in space to get our df dy. So these two essentially give us lines of derivatives or gradients on that surface. So you can see, you know, for a constant y, keeping y constant in that space, we can move along a y constant and get the gradient in x. Similarly, in the fdy, it keeps x constant and gives you a gradient in y moving along that. So there are essentially ways of getting the kind of movement or gradient, if you like, in each of the different directions. And the reason we can do this is because x and y are, you know, orthogonal coordinate system. So we've designed our mathematical system to allow us to basically split in this way. Okay, so just very explicitly for this field you see here, the derivatives we can evaluate directly. Now in general, the functions are too complicated to do this, but for a very simple field here, you can calculate the derivatives directly and second derivatives and so on. So this technique is kind of very, very well defined, and the process of taking this derivative, you keep y constant, and you go through and you differentiate x. Okay, so the next concept I want to mention is vector fields. So the idea of this is that the field we saw on the previous slide has a single value at each point. You can think of that being like a hill or a valley, it has a certain height at each point. A vector field is then essentially a vector valid at each point in space. So rather than just the height, you have two bits of information. So probably the most common vector field is velocity. And velocity would have an x and y component. So we're plotting here each point in space, an arrow represents the vector or velocity at that point. So when we talk about solids, when we talk about fluids, we're talking about, you know, flows at different points in space. So very explicitly, we can think of an example. Here we've got the same polynomial we've just seen. So the u component is just that function. And then we've got a v component that's a different function, if you like. So if we plot both of those together as a vector plot, you can see it's essentially a combination of both. So when we've got a large x value here, you can see there's a kind of large, the vector's in an x component in that direction. If there's a large y value, you'll see it moving positively or negatively in y. So this vector plot is essentially has two bits of information at every point in space. Okay, so the notation. Various forms of notation exist in the literature, and you'll see pretty much all of them. A lot of people use underline when they're writing because it's very easy to distinguish. And if you think about a vector, generally that implies it has three components. Tensors, if you say do a double underline, that implies, say, nine components. And then you can get a higher rank tensors that occur. There's also other notation. Typically people use bold notation for both vectors and tensors. Sometimes you see arrows over the top, and you can also see what's called index notation. I'll talk a bit more about that in a sec. But you will see pretty much every form of notation in the literature. This can make it quite challenging when you go to different books. Completely different notation. On top of that, we have extra notation for finite elements. So it can get quite confusing. Feel free to ask me. So we move on to vector calculus. Again, we've got this Navier operator. So this essentially is a vector operator that's taking a derivative in all three directions, x, y, and z. And we've got the unit vectors I, j, and k here. So you'll see this quite a lot in derivatives. Again, I'm just introducing this. This won't be required for the simple examples we do, but just be aware when you see this in the literature, this is what this means. And you can always just take this and multiply it out. You'll see it typically dotted with a vector, so it's an operator with dot u, and you see the dot product gives you the first component with u, second component with v, third component with w. Bear in mind u is u, v, and w in this case. And then if you have a scalar c, which is just some value, then that elevates that vector, gives you the gradient, and it gives you actually a vector of c in each of the different directions. So commonly you'll see these different operations. You can also do a dot of the operator with itself to get a second derivative, if you like, and then that's actually becomes a scalar. And again, you'll see that. I'm not sure we'll necessarily cover this, but you will see this notation for what's called the outer or dielectric product or tensor product. So this is if you have two vectors, and you essentially take the product of those, that will give you every permutation. So that's u and x, u and y, v and y, etc. And not often what happens when you're mathematically manipulating these terms appear. Okay, so just briefly, index notation is probably the best notation to use. It's the most convenient. I would typically avoid it in these lectures because it clashes with some of the finite element notation. So we'll typically stick to bold notation, but just again, be aware the literature mixes and matches this. When you see an index, what that means is that index can be 1, 2, or 3, depending on x, y, or z component. With tensors, you'll see, say, two indices that can be every permutation. You have three because they're three dimensions. If you're in higher dimensions, then you'd have more indices. And again, this Nabla operator here, gradient operator on P, which is a scalar, you can write dp dx, where x is 1, 2, or 3. And you'll also see this notation, where it's comma and then the index. And again, this was the one we saw in that first page of that of the first book that recommended. And essentially, that's very concise way of saying this is a derivative. So I've included this in case you haven't seen it before, but there are three rules of index notation. As long as you follow them, everything works out. So each unique index is a dimension. So when I say unique index, that means if it occurs only once in an equation. So if you have one I in an equation, that means it's at least a vector. The number of unique indices on each side of the equation must agree, which is physically saying that if you have a vector on one side, you can't possibly have anything but a vector on the other side. Then you have what's called the Einstein summation convention. So if you see a repeated index in any of your terms, that implies that you're actually going to do what is essentially a dot product, to have the sum of each of the three terms. And if you were writing explicitly, you would put the sum. But typically, the whole point of index notation is it's a very, very concise way of writing things. And then if you find an index has appeared more than twice in a simple grouping, you made a mistake, or someone else has. So, as I say, in the notes I'll try to keep notation simple and consistent. Please tell me if there's anything that doesn't make sense or I haven't done that, but we'll try to write all derivatives explicitly, and I'll avoid index notation, expand vectors, and make sure everything's kind of written explicitly. It's very easy just to accidentally do this, so that's why, you know, just keep bringing that up if I do, but you will need to be aware of these notations, and hopefully this is at least enough of a guide for you to go to the literature and that it makes sense. Then when we get into finite element analysis, it has its own set of notations, indexing, elements, nodes, numbering of tensors, etc., etc. So part of the reason I want to avoid index notation is it just, you end up with about five indices otherwise. Okay, so I've talked quite a lot. I think maybe if you want to just take a 15-minute break now and just spend a bit of time on this exercise, and then I'll go through this. But basically just to just have a quick try of play with this and just see whether these make sense. And it will hopefully give you just an idea of how much of this makes sense. So really for the first part, essentially what you're doing is just to identify whether this is a scalar, a vector, or a tensor. The second part is to use index notation. Now if you haven't ever used index notation before, don't worry too much, I'll show you that. But just to kind of, really I think for yourselves to try this just to see what you know or what you don't, then fit it in the form. If no one here has used index notation before, I won't mention it again. If everyone has, then we can work with that. So, you know, it's just to kind of give yourself an indication. And then finally, I'll put the Navier-Stokes equation. I'll explain this in the next section. Just have a look at that equation. You're feeling quite confident. Okay. And I'll pick up again in about 15 minutes. Any questions, by the way? Please feel free to shout out. Or completely confused or too basic? What's the feeling? Who thinks this is too basic? It's all seen all this before. Okay. Who thinks it's completely confusing, never seen any of this? Well, maybe fill in on the response and give me some idea where this is in terms of level. Feel free to take a break, 10 minutes if you can get up and walk around. This is optional. go through the answers to that. So for this first part, what would you say, is this first one? C is a scalar, and it's multiplied or graded with a vector. So this term is a vector, combination of both. You've got a vector times a scalar. Anyone with this one? Yes, so this is dot product, so you get a vector dotted with a vector, which gives you a scalar. For this one? Jensen. For this one here? Bit of a trick. I mean, this is actually a vector, but although you're doing a derivative with respect to time, it's still a vector. So time derivative makes no change to that, unless you're doing relativity or something. And this final one here? So this is a tensor here, dotted with a vector. The dot product of the two will give you a vector. So the reason I've done this is just to show you the index notation. Now, I'm not going to push index notation, but it is quite a nice way to work if you decide to get into something kind of more mathematical, because if you write this in index notation, you immediately see from the indices basically asks these questions. So dc by dxi, you can see here, is one independent index I. Sorry for my writing, it's not too easy on the screen, but essentially you can see straight away that that's a vector. There's one independent index. So that's a vector. With this here, you can see that we have dui by dxi. Because you've got the repeated index, you can see that we basically dot product all of those out and we get a scalar. With this, because we have the tensor product, you can see that actually we have two independent indices. So the del is with respect to j, u is with respect to I, and we actually have I and j, which gives you a tensor. If you multiply those out, you have nine components. This here, dui by dt, again you can see that just one single independent index, so that's a vector. This final term here, so the pi itself is a tensor, ij, but we're actually taking the derivative with respect to j here. So these would be repeated indexes, so it goes from being a tensor back down to being a vector, essentially, because you multiply this out and you end up with a vector. We'd actually have all three components with respect to j, and then this would be 1, j, dx, j. And then you'd have a vector here, which would be 2, j, dx. So you can see, and then the third component here would be 3. So you essentially have three components, and then the repeated index are just multiplied out. For the expansion in the Stokes equation, we'll actually come back to that in a few slides time. Does that make sense? Any questions on that? Like I said, I mean, again, if you've covered index notation, you've covered it. If you haven't, then, I mean, personally, you spent at least a year on this to learn it and practicing it, and you get used to using it. So really, I wanted to include it just because at least now you've got a kind of primer and you can go from there. It's worth learning so you can read the literature, but you can do without it, and you can always, you know, do things as vectors and keep track of things. But when you start talking about matrices with MATLAB and so on, generally you have to be kind of aware of these. One nice thing about index notation is when you come to MATLAB, for example, you would be accessing, let's say you had a vector pi, let's do a variable p, then you'd actually access that with I, comma, j. So the elements of your matrix would be accessed in the same way that you'd access indices here. So one of the advantages of working with index notation is it goes more conveniently to the kind of way you think when working with MATLAB. So gradually as you learn MATLAB, maybe move over to this way of working, but yeah, like I say, I'll do my best to kind of keep it as simple as possible. Okay, so let's talk a bit about application areas. So I'm going to just really, hopefully the notations, at least you understand enough to have a rough idea what these different equations are doing. I'm going to just give you a kind of brief overview of various equations that are used across the whole spectrum of continuum mechanics, and that is engineering simulation, and across a range of different industries and research areas. So one of the most common ones in physics, we don't really deal with it much in engineering, is the wave equation. It has a number of nice properties. You can see it's second derivative in time, and it's kind of second derivative in space here. And you can see it's essentially a scalar, because we have this dot product. The other thing about all of these equations is you can essentially make up your own equations, and there's whole areas of mathematics, chemistry, biology, where people essentially just make up an equation for the physics they're interested in. For finance, for example, black holes is like flow of money of some sort. For chemistry, you can say, we're seeing flow of this chemical, and we're seeing this much diffusion, so let's define an equation that does that. So these become kind of devices for you to mathematically express observations. In the same way that Hooke's law, you measure linear stress strain, with this, you're essentially looking at more complicated phenomena and creating equations that essentially describe as close as possible what you want to do. So, you know, really, most of the equations you find would have been formulated by someone as an approximation for something. However, there's kind of quite a historical context to continuum mechanics. So the original work where the assumption of the continuum was kind of argued between Aristotle and Democritus goes back to about 300 BC, and you know, this viewpoint that the world is continuous and that there are no atoms persists until about the 19th century, 20th century. So really everyone believes the world is continuum. And for all intents and purposes, you know, for the mathematical kind of derivation and really most of the kind of useful engineering measurements, we can assume continuous substance. Lots of kind of work on the early areas of continuum mechanics are done by Euler, Swiss mathematician who's pretty much done everything you can imagine. He's got his name on very, very many areas. But lots of the kind of early solid mechanics and formulation of continuum mechanics is done by Cauchy. Fourier did lots of work, you'll know from the Fourier transform, but also did a lot of work on solving equations as series of sines and cosines. So again, lots of work on these solutions to differential equations within continuum analysis. You've got Navier and Stokes here, who essentially together form the most important equation in fluid dynamics. And then Maxwell gets an inclusion here because I'll mention Maxwell's equations as another application of these areas. So this is solid mechanics, basically just the momentum balance equation. This is just Newton's law. I mean, pretty much everything you see is either mass conservation, Newton's law, or energy conservation. That's pretty much all of the laws of physics. So everything you see will be one form of those or other. This case is just Newton's law. You've got acceleration on the left here. Your forces are the divergence of some stress tensor. Now the tensor here for stress is modeling both direct stresses and then the shear components. And I'm sure you've done lots of circles and various kind of diagrams of this. But essentially this equation describes acceleration as the change in stress plus these external body forces acting on a solid. So this is often called Cauchy's equation. It's in a Lagrangian reference frame. So that's a reference frame that moves with the deforming, what's called a particle. We don't mean a particle in the kind of molecular sense. What we mean is a blob of continuous substance that moves and deforms, and you're following the movement and deformation of that substance. Now, this is the most common starting point for finite element analysis. The reason finite element analysis is very, very conducive to this form is because you essentially model some grid of points and then watch as that deforms, and you follow that deforming motion. So this equation is ideal for that particular reference frame. And the examples I showed before, essentially we use this equation in some form. This would be quite a simple linear example of that. This and this start to get into non-linear applications of that. So this deformation and moving with the substance might need to kind of introduce more complicated elasticity laws and so on. Okay, so the equation for fluid flow is the Navier-Stokes equation. Again, it's just a statement of Newton's law. On the left, we have the acceleration, written in what's called written in Eulerian reference frame, using what's called Reynolds transport theorem. So essentially what you do is, instead of following a deforming blob of fluid, you sit there and you watch the fluid flow past. This has some advantages in fluid dynamics because fluid deforms so quickly and in such a complex way, there's no way you could ever follow that deforming blob of fluid. So it's much easier just to sit there and just count what goes past. So this is essentially Newton's law, but written in a kind of different form. So we have the unsteady term, that's the time evolution of fluid in a box. or at a point in space. The convection term, you notice, is non-linear. So this is what makes the Navier-Stokes equation so difficult to solve. This is why you get turbulence and complex chaotic structures, and why planes, you know, are built much larger than safety factors require, because essentially no one can model this term, no matter how high they go with resolution. On the right we have pressure difference, and this is the kind of familiar idea of pressure. You see it on weather reports, driving the fluid flow, but also if you have a pump or in any situation where there's, you know, a differential between pressure at two different points. And then the diffusion term you can think of as just the spreading. So if you imagine ink dropping into a liquid, as it spreads out, that's essentially our diffusion term there. So this is a nonlinear partial differential equation, and it's essentially impossible to solve directly. There's actually a million dollar Clay Prize for just proving that it actually exists and has a smooth solution. So it's one of those equations that is kind of actively studied, but still fairly difficult to get to grips with. And some of the examples we have here, this is the direct Navier-Stokes solver. This one will incorporate the equation you saw previously, Cauchy, and also the Navier-Stokes equation, and couple those two together. This one, you have to simulate this and then add it in an extra equation for the liquid in vapor. And again, that's this idea that you can create equations to suit your needs. So as promised, this is the expansion of that equation as the individual components in X, Y, and Z. So just to note, it's a vector equation. So you know, the U, B, and W components. So this is actually three different equations, and it describes a flow field. So that's a vector at each point in space. And then just the same thing in index notation. So you can see again, you know, when we've got the repeated index, that's then expanded out to the individual terms. So one of those vector equations, so this is all three vector equations, but then each of those has three components of convection in each of the directions, and then three components of diffusion. So that's diffusion in all three directions. Okay, Maxwell's equations describe a unified electricity and magnetism, named after James Clerk Maxwell. These are a set of, that should be coupled, partial differential equations, and they're important for modelling electric motors, magnetohydrodynamics, and transmission of radio waves. So one example where this is used quite commonly these days is in design of electric cars. So you would actually do an electric simulation, work out locations where maybe you get the maximum heating, and then use that to design a cooling system, for example, coupled to a fluid solver and a solid solver. So all of these equations are kind of typically being solved together, and you know, things like Ansys and Abacus build them in. Heat flux is essentially a statement of the energy conservation equation. Similar terms to the Navier-Stokes equation, you have a time evolving part of energy. The advection, that's how much energy is carried by the flow. And then the stress work term is essentially the work done as the fluid shears. So that's how quickly it heats up. And this will include viscosity. And then you have heat flux, which is essentially measuring conduction. And Fourier's law is just a statement of a linear relationship between that heat flux and temperature gradient. And that would allow you to write this equation in terms of, say, temperature gradients. Okay, so the reason I've kind of shown all of those is really this is kind of the full range of all the multi-physics you see in your common packages like ANSYS. What we're going to do for the exercise is to actually take a kind of representative equation that contains lots of this, you know, fundamental physics. It has the kind of two-dimensional terms in terms of diffusion in X and Y. We have a source term as well as a kind of U-dependent term. And we also have these kind of material coefficients, potentially non-linear in the different directions. So this gives us an example of lots of these kind of underlying core quirks of the numerical equations that govern most of physics. And we can actually play around with this simplified equation and understand exactly how it works. So we're going to build up a numerical solver for this equation, and we're going to use that to understand, you know, various things like boundary conditions, numerical stability, and essentially how this works. And from that, get an idea of how then this applies to the kind of more complex model. I'll try my best to kind of link it in at each point. Okay. Any questions, by the way? Okay, so we're going to talk about how we solve differential equations numerically. So I'm going to talk about the finite element method. But just as a kind of, for completeness, there are various other methodologies you'll come across. Most likely you would have seen the finite difference method if you've seen anything. And this really is just a statement of, we have a derivative, let's approximate it as So there shouldn't be an I there. That should just be du, du, dx. And essentially what we're doing, the I's here are not index notation, they're essentially saying grid cells, or points in space. And we approximate our derivative as basically the difference between two points in space, and use that kind of idea of a gradient that we talked about before. So this is probably the simplest and most, you know, common use introductory method, and it's kind of requires uniform grids and very simple situations. Spectral method, so this is Fourier's kind of contribution, was to develop essentially a description of the solution to a differential equation as a series of sines and cosines. So sines and cosines can essentially describe anything. So the concept of Fourier's transform is you can take any signal, let's imagine it's a signal of like a complicated plate vibrating, and you can get the fundamental modes, so the fundamental structure. So any mathematical function can be represented as a series of sines and cosines. But the flip side of that is that means that the solution to any equation, any one of these equations, can be written as a series of sines and cosines. So the idea of spectral methods is essentially to evolve a solution in terms of sines and cosines as your functions. So these are great for very, very high precision numerical schemes, but unfortunately are very limited to boundary conditions. Firstly, sines and cosines have to be periodic, so you're very limited in having to model systems that go on forever, essentially. Unless you use some tricks, but just to be aware there are you know, an area of spectral methods for that. And then the final thing is finite volume methods. Now for fluid dynamics, this is the most common method for solving the equations. What you essentially do is rewrite your equations in integrated form. So you're, instead of talking about the time of evolution and convection at a point, you're talking about the flow over a surface. And you model fluxes over the surface and changes inside the volume. So it's kind of a reformulation. You can argue that finite volume is essentially the zero order approximation for a finite element. So we'll come to a finite element in a sec, but you can almost incorporate finite volume methods as a particular case of finite element methods. But, typically for fluid dynamics, finite volume is the more common methodology, although finite element is becoming more popular. Okay, so how does this work? Well, let's start again from our definition of a derivative. I mentioned that this is an idealization, a placeholder, mathematically where we're saying, you know, the derivative, if we could take the limiting case, would actually give us the gradient at that point. What we're going to do instead is just relax that requirement and just say actually what we're going to do is we're going to approximate that as a straight line. And that straight line between two points, f at x plus delta x and f at x, and we're just going to get approximation for our gradient. And what we're going to do is we're going to basically do that everywhere within our function. So we're essentially just going to take our complicated function of x and just draw a series of straight lines and approximate our function in that way. So the requirement for this, if you think about it as like a series of matchsticks that you're kind of sticking to kind of cover the function, essentially you need to make sure they meet at each of these points, which are called nodes. So the function we need to derive, essentially in order to do that, is a straight line between the various points that approximate this function as closely as possible. Each of those straight lines we're going to call elements, and the points where they meet we'll call nodes. So this is essentially the 1D interpolation. So just a quick note on notation. So these points, x0, x1, x2, x3, you can just think as just being points on the axis. This could be 0, 1, 2, 3, they're just essentially numbers. And then u1 is essentially the value of u at x is equal to x1 here. u2 is x at u2. So it's just this function u taken at that particular point. These points are nodes, and we've got elements where they're numbered. Okay, so our aim now is basically to derive a straight line which joins two node points, node u1 and u2 here. So the process is going to be, we're going to start with an equation for a straight line. This equation is just mx plus c for u element. We're going to stick in the values that we know. So we know at x1 the line has to have the value u1. We know at x2 the line has to have the value u2. So we actually essentially have two simultaneous equations. U1 is equal to mx1 plus c, u2 is equal to mx2 plus c. And essentially what we want to do is we want to combine those two together to get an equation of this form. But the first thing we're going to do is actually just to solve to get m and x. So I'm going to give you maybe 10 minutes just to have a go at that. So essentially what we need to do is solve in order to get the values for m and x as this is as two different, simultaneous equations. So in this case, u and U1 and X1 and U2 and X2 are just constants, and you're just basically rearranging to get a value for M and a value for C in terms of the other panels. And obviously any questions, please feel free to stick your hand up or shout out. Does that make sense? Is that okay? Okay, so the way I would do this, it's not the only way, but just to solve some tennis equations, I'd just label them 1 and 2. And then if we just take away 2, take away 1 from that, so we have u2 minus u1 is equal to, this is going to be x2 minus x1, and then the c term disappears, so c minus c. So now we can rearrange to get m is equal to u2 minus u1 over x2 minus x1. We can take m and we can substitute that back into one of those equations, substitute into 1. So that's then u1 is equal to u2 minus u1 four brackets over x2 minus x1 times x1 plus c. And then we essentially rearrange to get c is equal to u1 minus u2 minus u1 x2 minus x1. So we're going to multiply out x1, so we have c is equal to so this c is equal to u1, if you go back as you forward, so it's clear. So u2 x1 minus u1 x1 over x2 minus x1. Okay, so we just multiplied out both terms by x1, and then we can leave it in that form for now, although we can actually probably simpler to multiply this to get a common denominator for both sides. And then that's all over x2 minus x1. And then what we see is we've actually got u1 times x1 and u1 times x1, and can we arrange u2 minus x1 plus u1 x2 over x2. Mistake here, sorry, this should actually be a plus here. Being on the board. So because we have minus times a minus here, so we get a plus. And then this x1 u1 term cancels with this term here. So we end up with that expression. Okay. So then the next aim is to then get that in the form where we have essentially n1 u1 and n2 u2. So we're going to substitute both of these back into the equation for ux. It's not a really difficult one, but let me just write out. So the equation for u element from x. By the way, incidentally, on the blackboard, there will be all of these slides. These will be blank at the moment, but I'll upload the ones with the derivation. There's also just a file with just this derivation, so step by step. So just these key steps will already be in there. So you can go to look at that as well, just to kind of get a kind of so essentially what we have here, so we've substituted in plus the expression for C that we just derived, which was U1 X2 minus u2 x1 divided by x2 minus x1. So what we've done here, just to be explicit, we're taking ux, which is equal to mx plus c. And we're substituting the value for m here that we derive and the value for c here. Okay, so now the aim is to rearrange it so that we actually get it collecting terms for u1 and u2 together. So in order to do that, we basically multiply out this expression. expression here to get u2 x minus u1 x plus u1 x2 minus u2 x1. And this is all over x2 minus x1. And then we just collect together the terms. Okay, so we're just collecting together the terms for u1 here and the terms for u2 here. So if we do that, we end up with u x1 is equal to u1 x2 minus x over x2 minus x1 plus u2 of x minus x1 over x2 minus x1. And these are what's called interpolation functions. So that's n1 and n2. So we can actually rewrite that in this form here, as n1 for that element, that the x dependence is in that shape, that interpolation function, and n2 for the element x. Okay. So, what's nice about that, if we go back, is we now have a function that essentially describes this straight line. And essentially what we can do is we can put in any value of x, and the shape functions will actually then give us the value that interpolates between u1 and u2. To understand how that works, if you look at the form of the equation here, if x is equal to x2, then this entire n1 becomes 0. If x is equal to x1, this term becomes 0. So you can see that at x2, this is all u2, and then linearly it changes to u1 at x1. It's basically an interpolation function between those two. Now we can take derivatives of this function. So in order to do that, you essentially just do, so the derivative of dUe by dx is then equal to u1 dn1 by dx plus u2 dn2 by dx. So because all of the x dependence is actually captured in these interpolation functions, we can rewrite it in this form. And then dn1 by dx is equal to d by dx of, for n1, this is just x2 minus x over x2 minus x1. So x is the only term that's non-zero, so that then just gives you minus 1 over x2 minus x1. And following a similar process for dn2 by dx, we end up with 1 over x2 minus x1. So check that out yourself, but essentially it's just the same process. So we can get derivatives from this function. We can also integrate these functions directly. And the way we do this is basically between x1 and x2. If we're interested in the integration of u e dx, then it ends up being just u1 integral of x1 between x2 of n1 dx plus u2 integral. So essentially this whole process is one of taking this function dependence and rewriting it as a nice straight line, which makes life much, much simpler. The integration of n1 dx, we can show, is essentially the integral between x1 and x2 of x2 minus x over x2 minus x1 dx. Which ends up giving us, if we won't put the limits in yet, but the x2 just becomes x, this is the constant, and then integration of x becomes x squared over 2. And this is still the limits we put in, of x2 minus x1, which we can then rewrite as putting in the limits as x2 squared minus x squared, x2 squared over 2. So that's putting in the x2 limit, this is all over x2 minus x1, minus, and this is putting in the x1 limit, x2, x1, minus x1 squared over 2, again over x2 minus x1. So you can essentially see these two terms will become just plus x squared over 2, so essentially what we end up with x1 plus x1 squared over 2. This is all over x2 minus x1. So what you can do is you can look at this and you can see that it's actually the same as if we have x2 minus x1 all squared. And again, this is one of those things that I think if you have spent a while doing these kind of algebra, you spot, or you play around with it for a long time and eventually find a form that is kind of more convenient. But essentially, you can see that this is essentially of that form. If we multiply both sides by a half, this should be 2. If we did the product of x2 with itself, product of x1 with itself, and then it's cross term. That becomes 2 over 2 and a half. So you can see that essentially this whole expression is half x squared, x2 minus x1 all squared. So we can rewrite the integral of n1 dx as half x2 minus x1 all squared over x2 minus x1. So we just cancel one of those, which is the advantage of writing it in that form. You can do exactly the same thing for n2, you end up getting exactly the same expression. I'm not going to do it because bore you to tears, but essentially what we end up with from the integration of x1, x2 of u, epsilon of x for this interpolated straight line is basically the integration of u1 integral n1 x1, x2 dx plus u2 integral x1, x2 n2 dx. We end up with u1 brackets x2 minus x1 over 2 plus u2 x2 minus x1 over 2, which we can rewrite as u1 plus u2 x2 minus x1 times a half. And so this form is actually the form of trapezium form. Now, if we thought about this, this probably isn't too surprising because we've essentially replaced our function as a series of straight lines, and then we've done the integration of that. So integrating each of those straight lines essentially gives us the same process as trapezium form. That is, each straight line is just half the height divided by the length. Essentially, we have an expression for all that. So we've got about 10 minutes left. Okay, so hopefully this just gives you an idea. So I've put a set of notes that kind of go through this in detail. Spend some time to understand this, because the whole point of this is it's the underpinning for the more complicated discussion that we'll go through. And the idea really of a finite element method is to replace this complex function as a series of straight lines that join at the nodes. So a lot of the mathematics you have to work with is playing around with these functions in order to solve the equations. And it's worth deriving and making sure you understand how we get these kind of underlying functions here. So very briefly, just to give you a kind of tangible example, this is the case where we just put some numbers in. So maybe this has been a bit algebraic and abstract. Imagine you've got a function that's a cubic. Just this happens to be a form that goes through these various points. U1 will say is 3.2, U2 1.2, U3 is 2.7. And we're using 0, 1, 2, and 3. It's just the values of x. So what this means is if we're interested, say, just in that first element here, what we would do is we would say the first term U0, which is this term here. So for this particular case, that should be u0, that should be u1. We'll come back to global and local numbering. I mean, it's currently numbered for a local system, but just for this particular example, we'll have that. And essentially, u0 we know is equal to 0, so we can get rid of this term. This term we know is, so it's x minus x1 over x2 minus x1. And we know that's just equal to 1 because we've specified an integral of 1. So what we end up here is basically an expression that's going to be x minus 1. So the interpolation function u is just going to be equal to u1 brackets x minus 1. So I'm going to say spike around. It should be x1 minus x. Yes, so then we end up with 1 minus x. be equal to x minus 1, which we show between 0 and that should be equal to 3.2 times x minus 1. I think there's a mistake there, but don't worry too much. So basically this should be the linear interpolation of a line. And we can do the same thing. So just to convince yourself that this actually works, go through this example, just try it with these numbers. Hopefully you'll do a better job than I've just done there. I'll correct that on the slides. But essentially it's just a process of basically making sure what we have here is a way of approximating this function as a series of finites. So this is going to be the basis of everything else we're doing. And essentially finite element method is just doing this. I'll skip this for now. I just want to kind of finish by talking about an overview of what we do next, and this will be the subject for the next set of lectures. So in the meantime, we've got 2 weeks, so you might want to basically play around with these, make sure you understand essentially how these functions work, and do a bit of reading around the subject. I'll try and put up a few recommended sources, but when you go to the literature, as I've said already, there's lots of mathematical kind of detail. You'll also see various methods for deriving finite element equations. And very broadly speaking, most of the time you're solving equations for form AU minus F, which is 0. That's a differential equation. And you can think about it just being, say, a second derivative operator here. F as a force is equal to 0. So then that should become du by dx as a second derivative, for example. So this is just a very, very general form that most cases are written in, but essentially, generally you'll be solving an equation of this form, and you then want to rewrite it as a finite element equation of the form Ku is equal to F, where these are element stiffness matrix. Instead of displacements, so these displacements will be the changes in U in your function, and then these are the external forces acting on that. Broadly speaking, there are various methods, weighted residual and virtual work, force balance and energy, and I'll briefly just show you all of them to give you an idea. So conceptually what we're going to do with the weighted residual, you can think of it as being essentially least squares. What we're doing is we're defining our function as a series of lines, and we're using a least squares fit so that those series of lines are the best possible approximation for that underlying function. So the whole mathematical process is one of essentially getting the best possible approximation for the underlying function. And then this idea of the resolution, and the kind of as you go more and more elements, it gets a better and better approximation for it comes in. But essentially you work through the mathematics of this process, as we'll do, and we end up with a matrix of the form Ku is equal to F. And then from your MATLAB courses, you'll see how you can take a matrix of this form, just invert, move K over that side, and solve to get a displacement. So that's the weighted residual. Virtual work is kind of very similar. This is kind of the more mathematical end. It's based on D'Alembert's principle, where you use a kind of infinitesimal perturbation to your system, and that changes. You know, so it's kind of like a trial function that mathematically ends up making it possible to derive your equations using the virtual work form. So again, when you go through the literature, you'll probably find this term appearing. It's a convenient mathematical trick. You essentially use it at the beginning, work through the mathematics, and then say it's an arbitrary function, we don't need it. The final equation we've got gives us Ku is equal to F, and we can solve that. So again, the process is, you know, derive an equation that we can solve on a computer that represents probably the most intuitive form of the finite element method, and this is really the form that was originally used to derive the method, is to think of each of those functions you've seen as springs. So you can think of your system as being lots of springs joined together. In this case, it's just one spring. This is your element connecting point 1 and point 2, which are 2 nodes. And then you could write a dynamic equation for both of that. The force is equal to k times the displacement of the first node, or force is equal to k times the displacement of the second node. And you'll see in your MATLAB courses, hopefully, that you can actually rewrite those two simultaneous equations in matrix form. So we essentially write each matrix as a row, so each simultaneous equation as a row of the matrix, and then that gives us essentially directly this equation we want to solve. So in the simplest possible cases, we can do this. And this is like lots of these spring force balance systems. For simple cases, it's possible to do this for the individual elements. As it becomes more complicated, we need something like the virtual work or another methodology. And then just to link it to the final form, if you can think of these springs as essentially being beams, so they have an area, they have an elastic coefficient, so material property, and some length, then you can see the K is actually A epsilon over L, so A E over L. And in that form, you can then work through to show that the strain, stress strain energy of the system actually gives you the same form and the same equations. So I'm not going to go through this now, but again, you might encounter this, you have the notes. Essentially, we're using this kind of trick we've just seen, where we take a derivative of the displacement, we get two strain, the functions become just the derivative of our interpolation functions. As we've seen before, just 1 over L and minus 1 over L. I used x2 minus x1, L is the same in this case. We form that into a matrix, which we call the strain matrix. And then essentially you approximate your stress as D, which is just the elasticity. So this is just stress is equal to elasticity times strain. So this is really just the definition of the elasticity matrix, or Young's modulus in this case. And then we can actually just look at the energy of our element. And you work through all of this mathematics. Again, don't worry about it. Just the overall picture is essentially what we're doing is the same thing with energy, and we end up with the same form, Ku is equal to F. And you can check and show that actually if we do this, that the form of equation we get at the end is essentially the same. So the key point here is that all of the different methods you see are essentially doing the same thing. You have various conceptual ways of getting to the same solution, whether that's balancing forces, just looking at stress strain energy, doing a kind of least squares minimization, or using the virtual workflow. So have a read around the subject, have a look online. Any questions, my office is 105, or you can give me an email. Very briefly, you know, just to give you an overview of what we've got today, we did the introduction to the course, hopefully a motivation why you want to use finite element analysis. We talked a lot about functions, differential equations, analytical solutions, limitations, then some background. And again, please give me some feedback for whether or not this is, you know, you want more stuff on this. So there's a particular area here you want me to cover again. Obviously all of this stuff I'll cover again. This is going to be most of the topics, so I don't expect that. But these kind of background bits, if there's anything here you want me to cover in more detail, please let me know. And then the key point is to work through those derivations yourself, understand the notes, because this is going to be the basis of everything you do, literally and numerically. So make sure you understand how these kind of simple functions approximate how we use those. I'll stay around for a bit if anyone has any questions, they want to come down. Thank you.
Great.
So it's all based on the coursework. This 50% of the course. So the overall course is split 50-50 with the design element, which is taught by Mark. And then this part will be entirely for the coursework.
So 50 assignments, 50 for like project?
It's all, yeah, the entire assessment, all of the marks are for the project. But that doesn't mean you'll be able to do it without coming to the lectures and coming to the tutorials.
So
if you send me an email and say which bits, or do it on the online form, if you say which bits you need some more background on, I'll find a good source and I can send you give you some background on that.
Okay, so my eVision is not on, not my, the Blackboard is not working, I'll just make sure it works now and I'll send it.
Yeah, or just, you can even just do it on the registration on that pre-course survey. If you just put your name in there, I'll get in touch with you on that. If you just say, no idea about the following things, never been taught these, please can give me a good source to learn more about that. Yeah, of course, please do, and let me know which things. Like I say, I'll try and suggest some good sources so you can read about that. Yeah, because I mean, this is the problem everyone's from different backgrounds. If you've not done this for 5 years,
yes, I've been in the maintenance and operations field.
Yeah,
so I've never been into this maths.
I mean, I think even just doing spontaneous equations, if you've not derived things for years, it's kind of a shock to go back to doing that. So, absolutely, yeah. Let me know which bits don't make sense, and I'll find good sources and recommend a good background for that, good book or something. But yeah, hopefully it's we'll try and make everything quite self-contained. But yeah, absolutely. Let me know which bits that make sense.
Thank you.
So, from talking to previous students, from what I understand, this is the hardest course to pass.
Is that right?
This is the hardest module. So, do you have any feedback from previous students?
save this and then. Yeah, I mean, I've got some feedback from the previous. So firstly, it wasn't me teaching it last year.
Mm.
So I've inherited the course. It's Tom who taught it before. So part of the problem is it's quite complicated. And I think unless you follow the thread a bit, you know, you're left with basically a blank MATLAB code, no idea how to program. A lot of people struggle with the programming, with no background in that. Or if they can program, they struggle with understanding the theory enough to kind of write it down into code.
Okay.
A lot of people didn't come to the lectures and then complain that they couldn't pass as well, or didn't come to the tutorials. So I mean, it's difficult because I think you can't help people if they don't come. It makes it very difficult for other people. I guess the whole point of trying to get feedback is, you know, if things are not clear for lots of people, then we can spend a lot more time on that, and then we can make the assessment easier. But if everyone in the course is struggling and has no idea about that, for me, so the previous course was a two-dimensional derivation of that. When I go through that derivation, I think that's like really complicated. Not because it's not because the individual concepts are complicated. Like, you know, drawing a straight line between two points, it's quite a simple concept. But when you start doing that in two dimensions, for triangles, and then triangles...
Understanding why we're doing it.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah.
And then you end up with like 50,000 elements, and the matrix is massive, and it becomes really complicated. And so what I'll try and do is, I think, simplify and start with a simpler one-dimensional example, and we'll build up to it. So there's at least more... So I try, like, basically, I'll try and make the assessment simpler in that respect.